Greetings everyone, and welcome to another TOMTEC Academy webinar. During today's webinar, we will focus on the aortic root, in particular, TAVR and surgical planning. Joining me today is Dr. George Gellert. Dr. Gellert is the Medical Director over Interventional Echocardiography and the Structural Heart Program at Banner University Medical Center. Dr. Gellert also serves as an instructor of anesthesiology for Mayo Clinic Scottsdale, along with several other rankings and positions. Dr. Gellert brings with him today a vast knowledge of transcatheter aortic valve replacement using TOMTEC's vendor-neutral software. So, it brings me great pleasure to introduce today's guest, Dr. Gellert. Hello, and how are you, sir?
Good morning, Doc. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and I'm doing very well. And good morning, good day, and good evening, everybody around the world. And thank you very much for joining our presentation and discuss aortic root analysis with 3D echocardiography and specifically vendor neutral software technology. So we have a twofold objective today. One is I will walk you through step by step how to do 3D echo analysis of every part of the aortic root, what CT can perform. Two, to introduce you to a vendor neutral approach to this, because currently we have three vendors on the market by Siemens, Philips, and GE who can do 3D echocardiography, but all of them have their own proprietary DICOM system. So large institutions, imaging core labs have issues of looking at the various DICOM data sets. With TOMTEC, it's irrelevant what vendor obtained the data set. We can do the same analysis on every DICOM data set obtained from the three vendors. So starting off the presentation, first I would like you just to give a very short overview. What's that, what we're really trying to achieve when we do 3D analysis of the aortic root? What is our current problem with 2D echocardiography? If you look at this long axis view, you can tell by this MPR manipulation that this long axis view was obtained right here through the aortic root. And in this case, a measurement comes up here from hinge point to hinge point as we talk to do aortic root sizing and annulus sizing. 18 millimeter comes up for as an annulus size. But if I move this long axis view and position it over here, same aortic root, same point of time. Now we have a hinge point here and a hinge point here, and all of a sudden the measurement goes from 18 millimeter to 27 millimeter. So that's a 10 millimeter difference. And this is what we're trying to achieve on 2D echocardiography. Get a long axis view and measure from hinge point to hinge point. Look at the spread of error, what we can introduce by this technology. If I go further and just move that 2D long axis view just a little bit more to the patient's right, now there is a hinge point and there is a hinge point. Now the measurement comes to 22 millimeter. So as you see, within the same aortic root, three long axis views randomly giving us a measurement of 18 millimeter, 27 millimeter, or 22 millimeter. This is the ambiguity, this is the problem with 2D echo. We're measuring essentially on a two-dimensional screen the wrong structure. This is not what we're looking for. What we're really looking for is actually an invisible three-dimensional structure, the virtual basal ring. Just to very quickly refresh our memory, what's that what we're looking for on CT or on echo or by surgical sizing? Everything what you see here is the aortic root in color. Every part, every colorful part here, the sinotubular junction, the commissures, the leaflets, the inner leaflet triangle, the sinus of the aorta, Those are all visible to CT, echo, and to the surgeon. The only part, this very bottom part here, this green ring, the basal ring, is invisible to CT, to echo, and to search, and to the surgeon. The basal ring, which is called actually the virtual basal ring, and we also call it the annulus, is not a well-defined visible structure. It's invisible to all of us. It's nothing other than if you look at the bottom of the sinuses of the Valsalva, connecting the three lowest point of attachment in space, and where the connection cuts through the LVOT, gives us the bottom part of the aortic root, the virtual basal ring. That's what we're looking for. That's what the surgeon is sizing with the surgical sizing barrels. That's what CT is sizing when they are doing the 3D analysis. And that's what we should and can do with 3D echocardiography. Here you can see a rendering, a 3D rendering of an aortic root, and I'm just showing you one sinus of Valsalva. So here is the LV, the LVOT. Here is one of the sinuses of Valsalva, and then you see aorta here. So this is the aortic root. This is where this coronary leaflet is attached to the wall of the aorta. So you have to make note that the aortic leaflet attachment straddles the entire aortic root height from the sinotubular junction all the way down to the very lowest part, which is called the nadir, the lowest point of attachment, and then the attachment line comes back up again to the sinotubular junction. So the leaflet attachment is straddling the entire height of the aortic root. It's not a planar structure. And the basal ring is determined, or the annulus, what we're looking for, is determined by the three lowest point of attachment of the three sinuses of Valsalva. So how can we do it with 3D echo, specifically applying TOMTEC technology? We obtain a 3D data set of the aortic root. This is going to be a normal valve, a normal aortic valve, because I don't want you to be lost in the difficulty with calcium and shadowing. I want you to understand first the concept, what we're trying to achieve. Once we obtain the 3D data set, we want to find those three lowest point of attachments of the three sinuses of Valsalva. Once we launch into the rendering program, we will obtain the three MPRs, the three multi-planar reconstruction planes, just the same way as we do it on CT. We have on CT the double oblique view, we have the sagittal view, and the same called here is the coronal view. So the 3D data set is now showing here three default two-dimensional images. The short axis view, a long axis view, the correct oriented long axis view, and another long axis view here, what's new to our eyes, the coronal view. And what you see is that currently this MPR plane, this 2D short axis view, is obtained at this level. So these two dotted yellow rods are nothing else than this 2D plane looking at from the side. So the plan would be to somehow orient this MPR plane, just like on CT, to intersect the three lowest point of attachment of the three sinuses of Valsalva. If you're looking over here, I did the work. The yellow line in the sagittal view, this MPR view, is intersecting the right coronary sinus nadir, lowest point of attachment, the non-coronary nadir, lowest attachment, and the left coronary nadir, lowest attachment. And as you see, the yellow rods, meaning the annular plane, this yellow NPR, is intersecting the three nadirs simultaneously. This is the virtual basal ring, what we're looking for. So on enlarged, you can see that this is the right sinusoid Valsalva, lowest point of attachment, the non-coronary sinusoid Valsalva, lowest attachment, and the left. And I will show it to you, demonstrate how I do it. But if you look at this, this is the purple plane, and the purple plane currently is intersecting the right and the non-coronary nadirs. And this is the blue plane, the sagittal view, what you see currently intersecting the left sinusoid Valsalva, lowest point of attachment, and the nadir. And here is our virtual basal ring. This is the annulus what we're looking for. That is an invisible, non-well-defined anatomical structure only determined in space by the three nadirs of the three sinuses of Valsalva. Once we have that, then we can do measurements of the structure. As you can see, we can do planimetry, we can do area. So if we talk about a core valve, we can talk about an 83 millimeter perimeter. If we talk about a balloon inflatable device like the Sapien valve, we're talking about 522 square centimeter. We can also do minimum and maximum diameters. And as you see, there are all kinds of measurements what we can do just the same way as we do it by CT. You have seen that we could identify the annulus. Very quickly, I want to show you, we can also identify the annulus to left main height. Very important measurement on CT because it gives us warning if there is a risk of occlusion of the left main. And this is a particularly picked patient where you can see a very short left main height with a long leaflet. So clearly, if this leaflet has been pushed to the peripheral area of this aortic root, that coronary ostium would be at high risk for occlusion. CT does this measurement. We can do it with 3D echo as well. Here you can see that I can measure not just the height of the annulus to left main, but I can measure the height leaflet itself. So I can compare, and in this case you see that there is a 4 millimeter overlap over the left main ostium. We would do the TAVR procedure, but this patient's left main would be needed to be protected by wiring it and putting a stent in before valve placement. Can we do the same on the right side? We don't talk about the right side as often because the right coronary takes off higher than the left main, so occluding the right coronary is a little bit less often than the left, but we can also occlude the right coronary leaflet and that right coronary ostium with the right leaflet or the device itself, so we have to be able to do that measurement. What you see here is, and everything I'm talking about, I'm going to demonstrate in life in a second. As you see here, I'm measuring the annular plane to the right coronary ostium height. And also, we can measure the leaflet height as well in case you want to put an objective number on those two measurements. One of the most important questions to me in the operating room when there is a sizing difference, sizing issue between two sizes. Should it be a 23 or 26 or 26 or 29? One of the first questions what I'm asked at that point, could I give the size of the sinus? And on echocardiography, we traditionally use this image, this long axis used to measure the sinus width. Look at this. This is the purple plane. Make note where it's oriented. If you see these two sinuses, you must be by definition off from the largest cut, the commissure to opposing sinus direction. So you're measuring on the purple plane on your usual long axis view, you're measuring from here to here. That's not the sinus of the aorta. If you look at the CT experts measuring the annulus, the sinus diameter, they are actually measuring, giving us three numbers, three measurements. You can use them separately or you can average them, but CT measures takes three measurements to do the sinus measurement. So we have to do the same on echo. And the way we do it is, if you look at the yellow plane, it's oriented in the mid part, the widest part of the sinus of the aorta. And now we have this image, the largest cut through the sinus of the aorta. Now we can do exactly the same what CT can do. Commissure to opposing sinus, commissure to opposing sinus, and commissure to opposing sinus. Look at your CT measurements. You always get three measurements. Now we can do the same what CT can do with 3D echo. Sinotubular junction diameter, is that important? The answer is yes. Specifically for balloon inflatable devices, if the sinotubular junction size is close or smaller than the device itself with a short aortic root height, it could be an issue either for the balloon itself because the balloon reaches up into the sinotubular junction, or if it's a very low sinus height, the device itself could be an issue by itself. So the sinotubular junction measurement could be very important, warning us for a possible risk of sinotubular junction rupture. Once again, how do we measure it usually on 2D echo? We have the long axis view, and then we measure from sinotubular junction to sinotubular junction, and we give this measurement. Look at what we're doing. We're in the purple plane. Here is the purple plane. Basically, you're measuring from here to here. That's not the diameter of a three-dimensional structure. The sinotubular junction is as three-dimensional as any other part of the aortic root. So what you see here is that the yellow plane, the yellow MPR, is oriented to cut through in space the sinotubular junction. Now we have the entirety of the sinotubular junction in view. Now we can give a precise measurement of the sinotubular junction. And finally, one more measurement what CT can do and gives us, and one more measurement what we need to do. Again, it has significance of sizing. When the annular measurement comes between two valve size, the LVOT size can have a significance to it. How would I do that measurement? Once I identify the green plane currently is the annular plane, identifying the plane of the annulus. At that point, I shift the plane about 5 millimeters. So you see number 11. I shifted 5 millimeters down into the LVOT. And when I get that structure there, that's the LVOT 5 millimeter below the annular plane. Now I can measure either the minimum, the maximum, or if it's preferred by the balloon inflatable devices, the perimeter and area of this structure, the LVOT. At this point, I'm going to switch over and show you how to do these presentations in real life. What you see here is the TOMTEC system launching into the three MPR modes. Here you see the 3D data set what we acquired. Let me make just some gradient changes so the 3D image looks a little bit easier to the eye. And I also make changes in the black and white MPRs. Usually I increase the contrast to get the blood interface darker and decrease the brightness a little bit to make that blood tissue interface a little bit easier to see. So currently what's in front of you is that an acquired 3D aortic root is launched into the rendering MPR modes. You see the short axis view. This is left, right, and non-coronary reflex. And you see the long axis view in our usual echo imaging. So this is definitely the right coronary leaflet. we don't know currently what leaflet this is unless you understand the MPR arrangement, and I talk about it in a second. And then currently here you see another long axis view, which is not that used to our eyes, the coronal view. And the goal would be to find the three lowest point within this structure of the three lowest point of attachment of the three sinuses of Valsalva. What we're going to do, we're going to manipulate these MPR planes to get that job done for us. And I will show you two different ways to approach this. First, I'm going to stop the loop, and I'm going to find the widest systolic frame. Like that. You see that here is the widest opening. And the beautiful thing with echo, that we don't have to do what CT needs to do. CT is going to do the systolic measurement usually at the 30% RR interface, because on the bell curve, the patient's majority is the widest opening during systole at 30% RR. And then CT usually do a 70% RR interval for the diastolic measurement. We don't have to do it. We can visually identify, going from frame by frame, the largest systolic opening of the LVOT. In this case, I identified that this was the largest opening. What you're going to see first doing is how I do the measurements on echo, on an echo machine, and that can be done on any of the vendors. So that can be done on GE, Siemens, and Philips. Currently, what you see me doing is I rotated the purple plane into the middle of the right sinus of Valsalva, hoping that if you look over to the purple plane, we're seeing the bottom part of the right sinus of Valsalva. I'm going to move the yellow plane down to that level till I reach the very bottom part of the sinus of Valsalva on the right side. So here, if you look at, this is the lowest point of attachment of the right coronary sinus, and here is that point in space. I'm going to lock that plane in for now with this blue MPR, meaning that the intersection between the two planes are right at the nadir of the right sinus of Valsalva. The reason to do that, because I can move now these planes, and that intersection point stays in space. Once again, this is the echo approach, what we can do, because we don't have markers in echo to put in here what CT can do. TOMTEC has those markers, and I'm going to show that to you in a second as well, but let's go step by step. So right now we identify the right sinus of Valsalva nadir, the lowest point of attachment of the right leaflet. If you look into the image, you really don't see a lot of anatomy. You just see LVOT, because the red plane, the yellow plane, meaning the short axis plane, is a little too deep. If I rotate this up into the aortic root, you see anatomy coming out in the aortic root. Now that I rotated that plane up that high in the aortic root, I see left and I see non-coronary sinus of Valsalva. Now I can put the purple plane in the midpoint of this right sinus of non-sinus of Valsalva, and here you can see the bottom part of it. That is, I can move the yellow plane right below the non-coronary sinus leaflet, and we identified our second nadir. This was the first one, the second one, the right coronary and the non-coronary. And if you look back here, just by luck, we already see the left sinus of Valsalva, and that's the last nadir what we have to find. I'm going to shift the blue plane in there and make note what's happening down here in the blue plane. And I'm going to rotate now the yellow plane to intersect the bottom part of that left sinusal valve. So if you see the yellow plane, which is this, is currently intersecting the left sinusal valve nadir, the right sinusal valve nadir, and the non-coronary sinusal valve nadir. So here is in front of us the annulus. So this would be my way to do it on any echo machine I work in the operating room. We will talk about these shadows and dropouts a little later. Let me go back and see what TOMTEC technology can do for us, which makes it more comparable with CT and in a way easier to identify these nadirs. So as you see, we already identified that this was the largest opening of the leaflets, and I'm positioning the purple plane in the middle of the right sinus of Valsalva, meaning here we see the bottom of the right sinus of Valsalva. At this point, when I bring down the yellow plane and showing here the nadir, I can put a marker in there, just like CT. If you come up to this tool function, there's this little flag, and I can drop a marker. I don't even have to drop it right at that point because this is the plane what we're looking for. I'm going to drop it in here, and that marker now is going to be stay there permanently in light, in space. And I can label it as left. So I labeled it as the left. That's the right. Label it as the right nadir on the number one. Here it is. At this point, what I can do, I can rotate this blue plane and keep your eye here. Let me show you a little bit. Rotate this blue plane into the mid portion of the non-coronary, which is showing up here. So now if I move the yellow plane back to the bottom part, so I'm working right here now, I'm putting the yellow plane right to the bottom of the non-coronary sinus of Valsalva. And I'm going to put another marker in there. You see this little flag? And I'm going to put that marker now in this plane. So as you see, the blue plane and the yellow plane intersecting each other right here. So I'm going to put it in here in the yellow plane. That's going to be within this yellow plane, the label for the non-coronary. Let me accept that. And here I'm going to change it to non-coronary. So now we have two nadirs identified somewhere in space. Now we have to identify the nadir of the left sinus of Valsalva. So I'm rotating the purple plane in there. And in the purple plane here, you see the bottom part. Here is the purple plane. You see the bottom part of the left sinus of Valsalva. I'm going to shift back this yellow plane right there to make that structure completely disappear right below the sinus of Valsalva. So now I identified the nadir, the lowest point of attachment of the left. We're going to put a marker in there, in that plane, and we're going to label that as left. Now I have three nadirs identified in space. The right, the non, and the left. And I'm going to ask the system to automatically lay this yellow plane, the virtual basal plane, over the three nadirs. And here you got this image. And as you see, it is right, left, and none. This yellow plana automatically is lining up with the three nadirs, giving us the image of the virtual basal plane. Even more interestingly, if you look down here, it also did the same for the 3D data set. So if you look around, those three nadirs are cropped into the data set right at the three nadirs. So it's doing the work in both views. So let's go and do a sizing of this annulus. At this point, we're going to come to the sizing tool, and I'm going to just drop in these polygonal markers, just as you do it on echo or on CT, and then we make fine readjustments in a second. Here we are. And at that point, as you know, you can adjust all of these markers individually to be very precise. The goal is to go up to the brighter layer. What we learned, and we can talk about it later, what our experience is, that you want to push all the way up to the brighter layer. When you come to these shadowed areas, then you have two options. Here in this case, I can see that there is tissue layer, so I can just lay it over. If I didn't see anything at this 4, 5 o'clock and 7, 8 o'clock range, then I just bridge over the missing area, because we learned that we just follow the line of the aortic annulus, and there must be only one to four square millimeter difference, even if we don't clearly see the borderline in these very small areas like right here. And once I'm done with this, I get a perimeter. So let's say if it's a self-expanding device, this is going to be the relevant measurement. It's an 83 millimeter annulus. If it's an balloon deploy device like a Sapien valve, then we're going to say that the area is 540 square millimeter. And if you come back here, you can also see that now we have that measurement done in the 3D data set in 3D space as well. But as we building our measurements, all these measurements are going to line up here one after the other. So we did one thing so far. We found the annulus, we did the measurement, and we can add more measurements to it. We would like to know the maximum and minimum diameter, so we can do that measurement as well. Maximum and minimum diameter. And that starts adding up to the data collection. Also, if you see down here, it keeps adding up. So as the measurements we are doing, they keep coming in. Now, how should we identify other parts? So far, we identified the annular diameter, the annular size, but we have all those other measurements we talked about earlier. So how about finding the left main height? So what you see me here is rotating the 3D data set through the purple plane, rotating through the left main area, the left main sinus, the left sinus area, and look at the image what came up here. You see the hinge point of the left coronary, and you see the left main orifice there. So the measurements what I can do here, I can measure from the bottom part of the orifice down to the annular plane. So this would be annulus to left main. But I can do other measurements, what actually I prefer also doing, from hinge point up to the, from hinge point up to the orifice, and from hinge point up to the leaflet tip. So I can analyze if there is a risk of occlusion by the leaflet itself, or if there is a risk of occlusion by the device itself. Both the Sapien, both the core valve can cause occlusion itself, or the leaflet can cause occlusion. Excuse me. So now we made all our assessments on the left coronary, related to the left coronary ostium. How about the right? The right coronary leaflet is going to be somewhere here in space. So what I can do, let's look at this blue plane, and I'm going to start rotating through in space in that area, and I'm going to pay attention to this region here, seeing if I can come up with anything that looks like there you see it very vague under the current conditions, but there is the right coronary ostium. At that point, I can go ahead and do the measurement from the bottom of the ostium to the sinus, to the annulus. And also I can do the same what we did earlier to the sinus orifice down to the hinge point, and also measure the leaflet height itself. I know this right coronary is not as easily visible as the left was earlier, but most of the time it's there, and most of the time it's there even in a calcified aortic root, not as predictable to see it as the left coronary. The left coronary almost always accessible for echo measurement. This right coronary can be a little bit of a difficulty with a very heavily calcified posterior part of the aortic root, and a lot of shadowing comes in here, could be a problem. And then we can measure the sinus of the aorta. What I'm going to do, I'm going to bring up the plane, the short axis plane, to intersect the mid part of the widest part of the aortic root. So this is the largest cut through the aortic root, and now I can do the three sinus measurement, meaning from commissure to opposing sinus, commissure to opposing sinus, and commissure to opposing sinus. And those measurements are coming here as well. You always get the current measurements up here, and here in the data acquisition just keep adding up. And as I'm putting the cursor through the measurements, it highlights what measurement I'm showing at. And the next measurement could be, or would be, the sinotubular junction. So I bring up the 2D plane to intersect the sinotubular junction plane. You see that in both areas, I'm trying to intersect the top part. And here is in front of me the sinotubular junction. A little bit of an irregular shape in this patient. We can do two measurements. We can give one in this direction. And because it's not completely circular, one in this direction. So there's a little bit of difference between the two measurements, and there's a little bit of drop off here, but very close in measurements, but it's not a complete circle as you can see. And finally, if we wanted to do an LVOT measurement, I would just shift it down into the LVOT. So you saw that from the plane of the annulus, I shifted down into the LVOT. So now I'm clearly in the LVOT space. We can go down a little deeper there. And then we can do LVOT minimum and LVOT maximum diameter measurements. And with this, we have done all the measurements what we wanted to achieve. We did all the measurements what CT can do. And the only other measurement what would have some significance, not in the core valve anymore, but it can have some significance still for sapien valve, the sinus height. So look at the blue plane. It intersects the mid portion of the right coronary leaflet. So this would be definitely nadir here, and this would be the sinotubular junction. So this is the height of the right coronary sinus. The purple plane here is intersecting the left coronary. So this would be the sinus height of the left sinus of Valsalva. And again, in the blue plane now, you're seeing that we're intersecting the middle of the non-coronary. And that would be the height of the left, of the non-sinus of Valsalva. Once again, it's not as crucial anymore on the new core valve technology, but it still has to be under 15, over 15 millimeter. But with sapien valve, if there is a small sinotubular junction, then we start looking at the height of the sinus, and we prefer being it over 18 millimeter. And with this, Doug, I give you back the presentation. We went through every part what we could, and I'm open to any questions. Do you see yourself, or do I give you back?
I see it.
Okay, very good.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that very informative presentation, Dr. Gellert. That was some great stuff. I would like to go ahead and conclude the recording portion of the webinar. We will hold a brief question and answer session once the recording has stopped. For those interested in asking a question, please refer to the GoToWebinar toolbar question section and window, and you are free to type a question, and I will somewhat moderate that, and we can go there. So I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording portion.